warm welcome. When did you make that? 2 years ago, was it, or something?
This was my first time, as you can see. So, I mean, good thing that everything happened behind closed doors. No, but it was my first thing in film, yes. It was done in 1994.
And it was nominated for an Oscar.
It was nominated for an Oscar, yeah. That was, I mean, it's so strange. I really feel a little bit shy, because it's like, it's something that that we did with picking up on what we were saying in the morning. I mean, it's something that you do with, it was done in the University of Guadalajara. I'm from Guadalajara, from this, it's not a little town, but I think us coming from Guadalajara, it's a big city, but we feel ourselves from a little town. And we did this short film. It was everyone's first experience. Guillermo del Toro was the only one that had done a few things, but this was 1994, so it was way before he had done anything. That he had only done Cronos, which some of you might have seen. And all of a sudden, this little film became nominated for an Oscar. How does that happen? I mean, this was a student exercise, a thesis from not even from film school, because there wasn't a film school in Guadalajara as such. It was part of the communication program, Brava art program. So that's where it happened. And I remember coming back from school a couple of years after and hearing the news that it was going for the Oscars. And it really almost felt like a joke, but at the same time, everyone, I got a lot of phone calls from people, and friends of mine were like, "Hey, congratulations!" And I knew that I didn't. I mean, I say five words in the film, and none of the words are understood. I mean, I was mumbling at that time in my life. Nothing. And funny enough, I mean, when I was watching it, I was thinking, because we lost our luggage. It still hasn't arrived, but it might arrive soon. But I felt like I was in the same clothes. It's kind of more or less the same, but it's I was 15, and it was a beautiful experience. I mean, I remember it very vividly, the day one of shooting, day two, day three. I mean, it was done in 6 days. I was very, I don't know, it was very difficult for me to do it also, because, you know, it's the first time that they said action, I was like, how does this go? And this was a time when I mean, now I've been saying this all along, but now it's so much more easy to be in front of a camera. But before it was very rare to be in a camera that was shooting film, of course. And so we only had one take. Okay, so one take, we had to get it right. And so that's why sometimes the quality is not so good sometimes.
It looks good to me.
Yeah, but I think that, I don't know, was it possible to find a better copy, no? Like, yeah, it's only VHS, no?
It's all
that
they
have. It's all that, yeah. There must be a copy somewhere.
Film is a fragile medium, so, sadly. We're going to be talking for about an hour altogether. I've got a number of questions I'm going to ask Gael, and then I will throw the questions over to you. Did you make that? Had you already done some acting in television when you made that, or was that before you started in television?
No, yeah, I have done one. I mean, my parents are actors, so I used to participate with them in their plays every now and then. Or if there wasn't a part for a kid, we will always look for a part for a kid. Like me and a few other friends that are born, that are from the same generation, we went to visit our parents in the theater and stuff. And so sometimes the best way for us to go on holiday with them was if they put a part in the play, as you know. So sometimes we would play, and it was quite funny that sometimes you would come up as a postman. If there was a postman in the play, then it was a kid, the postman. You know, it makes it much more interesting than just the postman, no? Well, it depends on what play you're doing. But I mean, sometimes we used to do that. So I got a lot of practice in a way, and I have done one TV soap opera, full on soap opera when I was 12. But I mean, full on, like crying every scene, doing those kind of things, like big gesture dialogues, all of that. And this was the second thing I did in front of a camera. This time it was in front of a film camera.
Yeah, and you obviously don't want to waste the film, so it's very different. You said this morning when we were speaking that you initially didn't really want to become an actor because your parents were, and so it was just something you didn't really take seriously as an option. But at what point did you suddenly decide? Was it around the time of doing this De Tripas Corazón?
No, actually, even doing the Tripas Corazón, what I said, maybe I could, because I met a lot of people there that were film students, and they were all like, you know, they were all like outcasts in that time because nobody did film, so it was like, wow. And it was, wow, this is interesting, this world is really funny, and also the best thing is that they talked to us in, like, we were professionals already. Like, I remember Elvira Carrillo, the actress who plays the main part, she would, after the scenes, after the kiss, she would say, how does that feel? Does it feel right for you? You know, like, is this right? I don't know. I mean, like, if this is right, yeah. I mean, I don't know what I feel at that point, of course, but she would ask me, like, do you think we could do something different? do you tell me what, you know? I just follow, like. So that was interesting to be part of that. So in a way, film sort of kind of was something that that interested me, like from the side, but nothing that I would say I want to dedicate on this. And the least I would think is that I was going to be an actor in films. That's something that I didn't expect it was going to happen. It was until I did. Even after studying theater and having done Amores Perros, having done Y Tu Mamá También, it was like a little bit after Y Tu Mamá También that one day there was an epiphany of thinking, okay, yeah, I'm going to be a professional actor, that's going to be my job. But it was also thanks to Alfonso Cuarón, who made us feel that as actors we could also, we had a big participation in making this movie. We had a big sort of input. He would he would ask us, like, how did you feel? How do you feel? Like, those things. But this time, there was something that I had to say about many things. And he included that in the script. I mean, we rehearsed 2 months in Tu Mamá También, something like that. I mean, by the time we went shooting that film, we already knew the lines. And I mean, we already knew everything that we were going to say. And we didn't practice the kissing. No, we didn't practice that. That was left for a magical moment. but Alfonso really put us into the atmosphere of what it is to globally make a film. And he made us believe, which is perhaps one of the greatest things about a director, is that makes you think that you're in control of what you're doing, which you clearly aren't. I have no idea like what's gonna happen. But that's a good, good directors have that nature, I think, of making you feel like, yes, it's very important, yes, exactly that, what you said, yes, let's use that, let's put it, and then later they cut it. But it made it kind of, you know, the day went through, and it makes you feel part of this big act of faith, you know, of making the film. So it was at that point that I thought, again, with this kind of bluff that he plays, or this... magical trick he does. I thought maybe as an actor I'm gonna be able to work, like find myself in a good place in cinema, and that's when I thought, okay, I'm gonna be a professional actor.
I mean, you'd studied drama actually in London. Did you find when you look back, do you think you learned more by being a drama student? Or did you learn mostly through experience of working on with good directors?
Well, certainly, now that we're in this interesting scenario talking about studying. I mean, can I just ask a question? It's just many people are studying film here, no? Many people are want to be. I mean, there's any actors here? No. Yes. Many. Okay. Good. So I think that there was one thing that they were doing in my drama school, and it was a very funny thing at the beginning when they first put it, that it was like, let's do some exercises of acting in camera, you know, acting in front of a camera. Nowadays, that school, that same school, does like a whole semester of acting in camera, or even a year of acting in camera. I've seen that there's many courses that exist that are called acting in film, you know, and I just think that is the biggest, stuff. I don't know how to say it in English. A loss?
Bluff?
Scam. The biggest scam ever, you know, to say that, to teach to act in camera, because what there is to be learned in front of a camera is only really in one morning. You get what it is. Later you practice, but it's only one day, it's only one morning that you need like certain things of like, this is what happens here, this is what... There was this, back in the day, there was this thing of like, actors from the theater were very big and were like, you know, like establishing the stage, and it was like, you know, a long, long, long thing that things had to happen. But and there was this kind of urge of naturalism that involved a lot of fluids, no, as well, like a lot of it was like to be natural, and as if anyone, unless you're Slavozic, you talk like that. But if you're not him, then you kind of flow, no, a little bit more, right? And so there was this urge to kind of naturalize and to say like go down, no, less exaggerated, and it is like you can see in this film. I mean, we didn't know what we were doing, so some of the reactions are completely kind of innocently like it is a big brush that we do. It's big strokes in a way. I look at the short film and I think, wow, well, we've gone a long way now in terms of what. But this was our first experience in front of the camera, and really, like, most of the things that kind of I felt that I learned in front of the camera were doing this little short film, doing little. I mean, that's it. Like, you don't need anything more. I mean, I have friends that teach acting in film as well, and I have discussions with them, telling them, man, this is you're completely ruining people's money, you know? Like, because it really, I think it's a, I mean, interpretation, acting is something that that game is played in on the stage. Later, somebody transfers that into a film, and you're not in control. As an actor, you can't control it. You can save yourself with certain. With certain tactics, in a way, because again, one of the things that does happen in the world is that you encounter that you're doing this film, and the director has absolutely no idea how to talk to actors or even to anybody. Like, doesn't know what to do, and pretend and has to pretend that they do, but they pretend it really badly, and so you go okay, and then it becomes a kind of an act of that. Like, let's save ourselves, like, whoever can save themselves, escape, you know? So that's when tactics of knowing, like, okay, the director is saying to do that, but you know what, I'm not even going to do that. Or I'm going to do this and that, just for the sake of not falling into that tremendous trap of doing something that you know it's not going to be, it's not going to work. But then on the other hand, again, like, good directors, make a big bluff, and they tell you that we're doing this and we're doing this because of this reason, whatever, and you kind of understand it, that you rationally put and implement it there, but then later they cut that reaction to something else completely. And I don't know, when I worked with Jim Jarmusch, there was he would just say, and I would love playing that game of, because obviously you trust Jim Jarmusch, no? He's a very incredibly talented director, but he would say things like, let's just do a scene where the mountain is kind of coming towards you, and it's coming towards you, and you kind of want to maybe dodge it, you know, and that kind of thing. And that's all that's needed, because he needs that shot of me, like, looking at something that all of a sudden comes and goes and stuff. And then he put that into a wonderful little scene in this film called The Limits of Control.
And there's no mountain in it.
And there's no mountain. No. There's absolutely no mountain. I was looking at a mountain, but the camera never looked at the mountain. So, I mean, it is something that... So it's good not to know, not have any knowledge of what you're doing, but it's when you think that the director that you're working with has really absolutely no idea, then those little tactics of knowing how to work in front of a camera or how to, but it's just common sense, really. It's nothing. Maybe experience helps, but I think it's more common sense. I think I didn't answer the question, no? I went into something.
I think you said a lot of interesting stuff. One thing I wanted to do, ask is, when you have decided to take a role and you want to work on building up the character, you talk about having tactics of dealing with directors. Do you have tactics in terms of finding a key to the role? I once asked Isabel Huppert this question, and she said, yeah, it's the shoes. I have to find the right shoes, and then I'm happy.
I never heard that answer, but I was going to say that. Really, really, really. No, really, really. I never heard that answer. I never heard that answer, but the shoes is definitely one thing, because what happens with the shoes is that I like even doing films where the character doesn't change shoes at all. Because it's a film. You know? I mean, mind you, in real life, I hardly change shoes as well. But you know what I'm talking about. Like, I mean, if a character has certain shoes, then that's the character, you know? It's like all of a sudden a character wears high heels and not, or this and then red things, and it just changes the character a lot. And in a film, I like characters changing very few times the clothes. I mean, there is one good example. Did you see The Science of Sleep? This with Michel Gondry? Okay, in that film I wear only a suit, well, a kind of a funky suit, I don't know what. But it is a character that's always wearing that suit and a sweater. It was horrible, because sometimes, you know, in the summer we were like, you know, covered with these things, but it was great for the character, because then you go like, okay, that's Stefan, that character, that's the character, and it doesn't matter how many days pass, the character is wearing the same clothes. It's fantastic, it's actually quite... Nobody kind of picks up on the fact of like, oh, that's another day. Now he must be smelling a lot. I mean, nobody picks up on that on a film, or unless there's people that really care about those things and are kind of revolutionaries of continuity. But I don't really care about how many. Yeah, I like that characters don't change a lot, and the shoes is definitely one very incredibly important part. Actually, it doesn't matter what you're wearing at the top, it's until you get the shoes, that's it. Like, that's where everything can build. And I think this, I mean, to deconstruct it a little bit more, it has to do with the fact that the tactics have to do with work with specifics. Work with small elemental things that are tangible, that means something. That means something. Whatever meaning you're giving to them means just that, and the complexity will carry along. So, for example, I was just coming out of theater drama school, so this was during Amores Perros. But I remember I said, okay, I'm gonna to use this from movement class, and this from this class, and this from the, you know, like thinking about the what freshly things about grammar school, and there was this thing I thought about the animal mimetic, you know, and I had a dog in the film, so it was a great opportunity to say, okay, I'm gonna have the same breath as a dog, the same respiration, sorry, not the breath. So So the same kind of thing and panting, and throughout the film, I'm always like doing the kind of imitating the pant of the dog. Was that did that help? Maybe, maybe yes. I mean, it made me speak differently. It made me get very high and like, you know, dizzy and stuff. And maybe that showed in the film, but it worked. I don't know. It was something specific that I grabbed onto, and that made me help do the thing. But then again, I mean, those are choices that sometimes really matter, sometimes don't. For example, in terms of the much more psychological construction of a character or something like that, I rarely want to think about the character's past, you know. And this has to do with the fact that the past is something that gets you very immobile. Thinking about the past is a definition of who you are at the moment. Therefore, who you are at the moment is very difficult to express. I mean, if you ask anyone asks themselves, if anyone asks you, who are you? What do you mean by who are you? Well, yeah, who are you? Right now, it's like, define me your character right now. Define me. We're caught in a kind of like, well, I'm this person. I was born. You know, it's kind of difficult. But if somebody asked you, who do you want to be, or what do you want to be, it's a far much easier answer and a far much more narrative answer and a continuous answer. Something that is about. I mean, we're drawing into existentialism here, but the future is something that definitely we can hold on to. We can grab that horizon, and that can change. But it's better to ask the future of the character rather than the past of the character.
It's interesting you say that, because I have had a number of conversations with various directors, and they often tell me, oh, this actress wanted to discuss the backstory of the character a lot. And usually the director tells me, I hate doing that. You know, they don't have a backstory for the character, and they much prefer actors who don't want to do that.
It puts you in a place where it conditions. It's as if I knew exactly what my character would do because of its past, and then it draws you into a very kind of cheap psychological explanation. Well. This character was bullied at school, therefore that's why he is the way he is, therefore we need a flashback. You know? Like, it really reduces story to a very kind of non-elegant, non-sophisticated, non-plausible way as well, because then everything is defined like a superhero. Like, because of that instant, that condemns you to be the way you are. I mean, remember what was it? The Aviator, the Martin Scorsese movie. That film has the character's journey, or the character's embodiment, is defined by flashbacks that they do to explain why the character was the way he was. It's so unfortunate because really the film is brilliant without it. But then, because we have to draw, because then it has to be, again, maybe it's falling into what we were talking about, this Hollywood kind of way of like, well, it's not understood why he is the way he is, therefore we need one thing that defines him. Well, when he was a kid, he lost the red shoe. Okay, the red thing is going to be what defines everything. We need a flashback, you know, of that. And it's unfortunate when it's like that, because, I mean, we know life is not like that, and also we deny the complexity, we take it aside, we spoon feed everybody, but at the same time the character becomes like this cartoon of just one-dimensional character, two-dimensional, sorry.
You mentioned working with Alfonso Cuarón on Itumama Tambien and how he worked very closely with you and Diego and got your input. Do you like working with directors who encourage you to contribute? I mean, just not, obviously you're going to contribute whatever you do, but who like you perhaps to improvise a bit or to play around with the character and the script rather than stick rigidly to the script.
Yeah. I like working with directors that involve me in some sort of way. Because what there is an exchange that happens that is very pure, and it's more or less like can be defined as kind of like the golden exchange, a golden sort of thing happens, which is the trust that goes. And there is something that happens that you do an offering in a way as an actor. You offer yourself to this journey that one person has, because really ultimately the films are about one person's point of view, and you offer whatever interpretation you can have of that point of view. You embody it. You put your face there. You're very vulnerable in this situation. And when there is a reciprocate feeling of gratitude and at the same time of involvement from the director, it is incredibly appreciated, because then all of you are in the journey towards transcendence, towards doing something that will transcend, hopefully. And I like that feeling. I like that game. I mean, I like it. It's a very fraternal experience, It's so far the best experiences I've had, and the best films that have come out of those experiences have been done like that. So I have strong reasons to say that that's how it should be, I think. Or at least for me. I mean, I don't know. There might be actors that enjoy not getting involved and just really doing this martyrdom in front of a camera and letting that become whatever it is, but I can't separate from it. I mean, this is I'm just an actor in this little short film in the Tripas Corazón, but it's a piece of me, absolutely. I mean, it's a piece of my pancreas, even my guts. I mean, I can relate completely biographically to the state I was at that point, who I was, what I was doing, what I thought about the perspectives. I mean, I remember there was the Mexican elections when we were shooting the film in 1994. It was the beginning of the Zapatista movement in Mexico as well. It was the beginning of my adolescence strongly, I mean, like independently, and a little later I went to Cuba to study, and I don't know, I remember like which girlfriend I was dating at that time. You know, things like that, and it is therefore that's why the exchange should be this coming on forth of gratitude, no, and of joy.
Have you ever been surprised by a film and sort of you've made it a certain way, and then when you see the finished result, it's very different to what how you expected it to be. Have you ever had that happen?
Yeah, well, it happened to me recently in a very strong way with this film called No, this Chilean movie. Maybe not so many people have seen it.
You're clapping.
Okay, you've seen it. Okay, well, that film, it was a film that was shot with a small pneumatic cameras from the 80s. And we had a digital backup, of course, but there was it was done with this kind of cameras that we're used to do reportage with in the early 80s. And what was interesting about that experience is that the cameras are silent, and they are kind of, sometimes they work and sometimes they don't. So you never knew quite well when they were shooting and what they were shooting at all, because the lenses were the same, you know, kind of. So it was a very strange rapport with the camera. It was a different one. The cameras would fit in here, and the shot would look wonderful, you know. And it had a strange zoom as well, which I don't know. You couldn't know where you were standing at that point. And the same with the story. We never knew what was going on, because we would just improvise the hell out of that story. I mean, we shot enough material to do a TV series with, which actually they ended up doing a TV series out of all of them in four parts, and that's divided, it's more or less 5 hours. And so they did the long version way after, but first they cut it into a film. So when they cut it into the film, I was really surprised by the film, because I was like, wow, okay, so much stuff we did is not in the film. So much, many things that I was holding on to and is not in the film, but wow, this works incredible. I mean, this is a really, really good film. I mean, I really enjoyed it. I really loved it. It was perhaps one of the few experiences where I had completely no idea how it was going to come out. It was either going to be terrible or it was going to be fantastic, and it turned out, I can say it because I feel very distant from that process of creating the film, the post-production and everything, I felt it came out fantastic, you know, but it did happen like that. It's not that I was feeling that it was going to be bad, it's just that I had no idea, like, I was completely, yeah. And there's been situations where also I thought that this was going to be brilliant, and then it didn't came out as brilliant, but I'm not going to say which ones they were.
Are there any that turned out better than you expected?
Yeah, but I'm not going to say which ones. Yeah.
Okay. One thing I wanted to ask you, I mean, I know you're a real cinephile anyway, you love movies and you know a lot about movies. And when you were very young, were there any actors that you particularly admired, particularly liked watching, and who later on perhaps you thought, oh, I could do some of that? I'm not talking about direct influence, but any, you know, that you may have just sort of learned from just by watching them a lot, or what they do.
Well, I mean, in the theater, there were many actors that I would look upon and I would say, oh my God, I wanna play something like that. I wanna be in that. I wanna participate with that actor, or you know, I wanna be like that actor, knowing them afterwards, you know. And in film, what happens is that it felt so distant that I never thought I was going to. But then again, I mean, there is something there that's quite meaningful, is that until now, there's not a film I see and I think, oh, I wish I was doing that. I don't think of that about films. But when I watch a play, I definitely go like, oh man, I should be doing theater. I should be doing this. I should be playing with this. I should be having fun, I should be having this family, I should be, you know, working with 15 people every night and enjoying this kind of experience and being a bit more stable, blah, blah, blah. I'm projecting, of course, you know. But what I'm saying by that is that when I come out, when I see a film, when I see a play, I feel the urge to play in the same game that they're playing. And when I see a film, I want to come out of the film and I want to, in the best cases, feel this feeling of, I want to live, you know. I watch a good movie and I go, oh my God, I wonder how, you know, I keep on the kind of the line of the movie. Therefore, I never felt that I wanted to be in a movie. And that might sound a bit pretentious, but it's true. I mean, I never felt there were any actors that I was like, I wish I was like, I was just, I liked them a lot. But I never wanted to be, to emulate them. And for example, actors that I liked a lot when I was young, and I felt I was discovering them because back in the day when there was no internet, it was wonderful that you would go into a cinematheque in Mexico City. There is a huge cinematheque there, and I would go in, and when they wouldn't. When I would arrive late at school and they wouldn't allow me in, there were shows at 10 a.m. in the Cinemateca, no? And so it was like, excellent, let's go to the Cinemateca. So I would buy whatever they were showing at 10 a.m. So sometimes that's how I got to see Theo Angelopoulos' first movies, which is great that it was in the morning, because at that age I would have slept a lot. I mean, really, in the night. Would have been, I mean, I got into the, but I had no idea that it was Theo Angelopoulos, who he was or anything. Even Wim Wenders, for example, I had no idea who he was, and just going there and going back to school and saying, hey, there's this great director called Wim Wenders, German, he's fantastic, you should see. And everyone was like, what? Like, what are you talking about? And in high school, you would have these kind of conversations, and it was incredible that nobody could check on who the inventors was. Like, and it was like your discovery. Like, I saw Paris, Texas. I'm the only one. You know, I'm like, guys, have you seen it? No, okay. So, therefore, the VHS copies or beta copies would kind of roll around somebody that had one. And it was a great thing to look, for example, that, and this is maybe the first time that I met, like, that I saw a director, all the Herzog movies. There was a cycle of Werner Herzog in when I was 16 in the Cineteca, which lasted like 6 months or something. And I saw whatever, I mean, I felt I saw everything. Maybe it wasn't everything, but yeah, definitely some short films it wasn't. But I remember watching Fitzcarraldo and Aguirre back to back and thinking, wow, like, I like Klaus Kinski. I don't want to be like Klaus Kinski, but I like Klaus Kinski. I like that kind.
Did you read his book?
Yeah, I read it. Yeah,
you don't want to be like Klaus
Kinski. Yeah, yeah. That point, it was. I mean, yeah, it was such a shame when I read it. It was like, no, but I mean, but Klaus Kinski, yeah, like fantastic. You know, like how Klaus Kinski was somebody that, you know, let me go. And, or for example, I was 14, I think, and it was the first time that I saw Jamón Jamón. And saw Javier Bardem, and I was like, whoa, this guy, he's good. He's really incredible. And many actors, of course, from Hollywood that I would admire a lot. Like, I know Daniel Day-Lewis, for example. I mean, I got to know him through his Hollywood movies, not through the theater in England, of course. Many, especially many more actresses than actors, actually, that I felt were incredible. I have a bigger list of actresses that I like. I mean, for many reasons. But it's true. I mean, it's a. What is it? Is it? This is a very frank question. Is it correct to say actresses still in English?
I say actress.
Okay.
And I know a lot of women who call them actresses.
Ah, okay. Okay, well, many actresses, actresses are better actors than male actors, I think, in general.
Can you name some that you particularly admire?
I think for every good actress, for every 10 good actresses, there's one good male actor. That would be the I think that's the percentage, more or less. Okay, I was talking about actors I like. When the first time I saw in this escapades to the cinema and watched Juliette Binoche, of course I was completely in love, and not only she's a great actress, but I was already marrying her. I mean, like, if she wanted to, of course, but then I was completely transfixed by her in every way, shape, or form. There's so many, like, for example, when we worked with Maribel Verdú in Y Tu Mamá También, we had seen Belle Époque and Huevos de Oro. Have you seen those? Okay, the Vigas Luna and Fernando Trueba movie. And when Alfonso Cuarón told us it's gonna be Maribel Verdú, me and Diego were like, really? Like, Maribel, no, man. Okay. I mean, the moment that Maribel opened the doors to her apartment for us to do their first rehearsal and get to know her, it was unbelievable. The amount of, we were 19, Diego was 19, I was 20, and it was like, wow, man, what's happening? This is they're creating a monster, man. I mean, yeah. So, it is definitely I've dreamt about actresses. In I still do, and I ended up marrying an actress. So my mother is an actress. It's all very how do you say Edipo. Edipo. Okay, Edipo. It's very Edipo.
we won't pursue that any further. Given that there are people here who want to become actors, I mean, do you have any particular advice that you would like to give in terms of progressing their careers? And I don't mean sort of practical stuff so much as, you know, just ways of working on oneself. Do you have, you know, because you've made it, you've done very well for yourself, and presumably, apart from being a good actor, you must have done something right to become a good actor. And
well, I mean, it's a, it is a very sort of strange career because, in a way, I've always felt very vulnerable, and kind of putting myself in front of a camera was always an issue for me. It still is. I mean, if in a way, if I do a character, then I feel protected. You know, if I'm acting something out, then I feel protected in front of a camera. And if I understand the context of what we're doing and everything, I feel sort of strange protection. But there is a lot of vulnerability in this, and the problem is that the, like Dieter was saying about yes, it is about the money. No, he was saying something about the money, that it is about the money, but it's about something else. And the whole money, or the whole industrial aspect of being an actor, it's really gruesome and can really contaminate and hurt everyone's journey. Absolutely. I mean, it's a very delicate thing. I mean, that's why maybe they urge still, and it might feel antiquated, but they urge in drama schools not to work professionally whilst studying. And there is a reason for that. I mean, very, very few people are able to pull that off. But there is a good reason for that, because to be, it's again the same thing what we were talking about, rehearsing or shooting. I mean, to be in drama school, you're rehearsing. You're rehearsing and preparing and building up strength. And then when you come out, you're going to be performing. And there is a mechanical, industrial side of it that will want to establish that narrative in front of you and would want you to work in that narrative and obey those rules of there is a journey, you have to do this, now you have to do that, now you have to cater for these people, now you have to talk to this person because then you can do this, and maybe TV is going to get you a lot of audience, and then therefore they can go to see your play, which is really your passionate project. I mean, this is not a new thing, what I'm saying, and there's been great songs done about it, like Pink Floyd has Money, and you know that song. I mean, it is there is something there that completely falls into this kind of whirlwind of thinking that this is the correct thing to do. I remember in the third year of drama school, people were saying, well, I have to get an agent, I have to do this photos, I have to do this, I have to do that, get a mobile phone. I mean, at that point it was like, get a mobile phone, why would you need a mobile phone? Because the agents can call you at any time. Really, that was one of the arguments, of like, they can call you for work at any moment, you know? And you had to be there. And me, that I was feeling completely aside from that and not buying that kind of journey, even though I felt protected. In a way, there was something inevitable that I would have to consider it a little bit, and I would have to think, okay, maybe yes, maybe I should, maybe I should do this, and maybe I should do that, Times I made decisions because of that. It's never worked. It's never been. There's no perfect plan, in a way. It's always been accidental. And for me, it was definitely an accident. I mean, I was, my first feature film that I was called to do was Amores Perros, and then the second one was Y Tu Mamá También. So it is quite lucky. I mean, it's fucking lucky. I mean, like, unbelievably lucky to have that happen. But at the same time, maybe it has to do with for a reason, because I had to say no to many other things that I could have. I mean, it sounds weird to say it now, but maybe I could have just keep on working in soap operas in Mexico, you know, and therefore I wouldn't have been called to do Amores Perros, maybe. So I don't know. I mean, it's what I'm saying is that there is no specific sort of dream of purity that one can pursue, but there is certainly certain things that you can sort of put aside, so that that accident or whatever, if you believe in destiny or in everything or whatever is held out for you, can be channeled. But it is a very fine art to listen to oneself. It is a very fine art to say no to certain things and to not buy into this kind of problematic. And it's certainly much more easier for men than for women to do this, because there's more parts for men. For women, it's much more reduced, the possibilities, and not only that, there is, maybe 50% of the characters written for women are just an excuse for the character to be not gay. Sometimes that's the only the reason why the woman character is there, so that the guy, so that nobody says, where's the girlfriend? You know, like, so you know, I mean, I think that it is strange to the journey that one goes into, but maybe the only other thing I would say that is not as kind of, you know, like abstract as what I've been describing, is that it is important to challenge strongly one's perception and one's point of view, because as actors we're able to put ourselves in front of the camera and receive the slap, and we can get used to receive many slaps, you know, like think that things that we do are not so good at that. But that builds something that kind of builds a naturality to what we do, and understand that this is just a game. I mean, there's no people demonstrating outside here that saying you guys should be good directors or good actors. I mean, it would be great if that would happen already, but saying you must come out here being fantastic, you know? And there's no people demonstrating that one should do a movie, I mean, like, or that it should be good. So it is important to know that this is not as important, that this is a game that can have amazing, transcendent consequences, but in general, the point of departure can't be that transcendence. It has to be something that is, it's just a game. It's just a really good game to play. Yeah.
Okay, we've got a few minutes now, just wait for the mic. Thanks. One thing I would say is, obviously we've been talking about acting, but Gael has also directed some films, so if you want to talk about directing as well as acting, I'm sure that's probably fine.
I want to ask, my name is Seth Becker, I'm a film critic. I want to ask Mr. Bernal about his new film he done with John Stewart. It's just premiering at Toronto Film Festival. What was your collaboration with John Stewart?
It's a film called Rosewater, and it's John Stewart, the director. He's a famous comedian in the United States. He has a really good show called The Daily Show, and he's been doing it for many, many years, and it's his first time he directs a movie. It's a film based on a book written and lived by Maziar Bahari, is a journalist from Iran, Iranian Canadian, that he was put in prison, and he was put in prison during the last Ahmadinejad re-election, when there was the Green Movement and everything, and he was put into jail and forced to confess that he was the mastermind of a soft revolution that was happening against the system. And I mean, it's an interesting book. I mean, it's difficult to explain. I would invite you all to read it if you can. But the film is coming out soon, so you will find out much more when you see the film.
Hi, my name is Mattia. I'm an actor. Can you please comment on performing in foreign language? English is not your native language, so can you comment a bit on?
Yeah, definitely. In Spanish, I feel much more at ease with in acting. I mean, because I can play much more characters, I can have a lot of fun and have a lot much more flexibility. And I think ultimately that's the. You know, there is this concept of he's a good actor or a bad actor, no? I mean, like, there's that kind of aesthetic definition of good and bad, no? But I would say that technically what happens is the definition of the real definition, technically speaking, of an actor being better than another has to do with the flexibility. That's it, because one actor can be non-flexible at all, but can be amazing in whatever film or play they are playing. I mean, if for example David Lynch, I mean, so many great characters that have appeared in his films, yet the actors are not the most flexible ones. He even uses actors that are considered in the, like, I don't know, industrially speaking, not so good actors, you know. But then they're working his films, and it's just incredible how they kind of completely become amazing. And it's just because the casting is amazing, and because it's a director's responsibility. And really, whoever wants to be a director here, you will be held responsible. I mean, it's not, you can never say that an actor in your film was a bad actor. Never. It's your responsibility to make them look like geniuses. Ultimately, it's your fucking fault to have casted those actors, really. I mean, it's you have to. It's casting. It's director's responsibility to make people look brilliant. I mean, yeah, because it's not the fault of the actor, really. It's people that choose them. So it's. I think that in Spanish I have a bigger flexibility, and in English I have a very reduced flexibility. I feel like I cannot play that much or. I'm not in control of what I'm doing as much, which sometimes might end up being good if I'm casted in the right thing. But if I'm not, then I end up terrible. I can be the worst actor. I mean, really bad. Yeah.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm an actress, but as you said, you didn't talk much about directing and production. And a lot of people here are the directors and producers, so if you can say something about that.
Like what?
I don't know, something for them. I heard everything for me. I don't know.
What is a good way for a director to direct actors?
Okay. Well, it's always a case-by-case situation, right? I mean, it depends on the movie, you know? I mean, I like what I was saying of this in general, kind of having a, you know, a correspondence with the directors and getting into a kind of a rhythm of work where we all feel we are part of this kind of boat, of this ship that's sailing somewhere. But I think directors should know from the beginning that there's something they know that people don't know. That is a good way to begin, and that's not a superiority feeling at all. I mean, it's not that they know something better or they know better than the other. No. They just know something that the other people don't know, and that's their personal point of view and how they're gonna shoot this and where they're gonna put the camera and how's it gonna look like and what it's gonna cut to. That's something that actors really don't know. Yeah? You don't need to know. In the best of cases, yeah. You don't need to know. And therefore, that allows you to have a very interesting way of a relationship, of doing magical tricks, in a way. And of achieving what that director wants through that knowledge of thinking, okay, there is something I know that they don't know. They are offering me something incredibly big, and I have to be able to sort of use whatever I need, whatever is needed to do this, but without breaking. For example, the worst indication would be like to say to an actor. I'm trying to think of a good example, eh? Because okay, for example, there is this scene, and the director says, okay, cut, okay, good, really good, that was really good. Let's do one where this is happening and it's a little bit more believable. You know, let's do something that it's a little bit more believable, because it was okay, but I just then the actor at that point goes completely like, what the fuck, what is this? I mean, what believable? What, I mean, abstract concepts of like that are completely subjective as well. I mean, because by the end of the day, even whatever you do for that director, it might seem unbelievable everything you're doing, and you can never convince. Like it's like saying who wins, Superman or Batman? Superman. No, or you know, it's like, and you can argue Batman, and the end of the day, the director says, no, it's Superman. You know, it's that kind of thing of like, it would be the most stupid direction to say something like, let's do something more real. I mean, real, like, we're doing a film, come on. It's like, we're inventing a reality here. Maybe real for the reality of what we're creating, but nothing to do with a reality as such, you know. So there is I've been in situations where people have said things like that, terrible, like, or I had this director say once, okay, let's do it, but let's try this with more drama, like, and action, and it was like, whoa, no, hold on, cut. I mean, how the hell are we gonna more drama? What does it mean? Like more tears and shouting? You know, it's just really weird. So, you know, you have to be a good storyteller to involve your actors into this kind of world. I mean, Jarmusch tells you to look at the mountain coming at you. That is a great way of directing, really. It may be the best, because it is giving you something specific. Like, let's do this, and whatever you do is going to work. Because, he just gave you an indication of something. Or, for example, there's old style... this old style notion that there is a good profile and a bad profile, no? I mean, that doesn't work anymore, but it used to be, no? Like, it used to be that actors knew their profile, their good profile, and that would be the worst thing, because to be self-conscious is what sticks you, like, doesn't allow you to move forward. I mean, it's a... if somebody says, hey, yeah, that's the way you look really good with that haircut. Like, okay, I'm never gonna change it. You know, like, that's how it's always gonna be. And I don't know, I think that's there's many things to say about what not to do, but there's very few things about what to do. I mean, to say about what to do, because it really is. I mean, there's directors like Woody Allen that do not direct, apparently, that they just tell you, okay, and possibly one of the best indications, which is let's just do this again, but faster. That's always a good indication when not knowing what to say, because it makes everything it freshens up things. I mean, just say, okay, it's good, it's already good, it's like looking at Messi doing a bicycle kick and hitting it and scoring a goal, and then you go, Messi, let's try that again, but with a, can you do the bicycle kick on the angle? And he was like, what do you mean? Like, you know, that's, you have to direct Messi and ask him to do something, another thing that's brilliant, but that's maybe more to do with what you want, but nothing to say like, can you shoot it, because this one doesn't work, let's do it in the end. He's like, man, come on, it's Messi, who can do that? It's like, there's actors that feel like they play like Messi.
have we got time for one more?
One more question.
Okay, one more.
Just to continue this conversation, if the actor does something wrong, how can you encourage him and say to, like, change the direction and do, in your cases, how did you do at that moment? Like, he did something that is not right, not good, but you say that it's good to encourage actors all the time.
Well, not, I mean, I don't, well, obviously we're going into, we're talking in general, and it's very difficult to say when an actor does something that is wrong or not good. It's like, what would that be, right? Yeah. I mean, wrong in what sense, like...
Many actors in this part of the world are exaggerating, but I mean, you know that from the Mexican soap operas too. And when you're working with them, it's so hard to make them real. Like, so what should we do? We just need to take them away and play with, work with real ones, like not actors, or what will be your suggestion?
And you think, okay. So when no, it's okay, no, but it's like, so real people act, and actors act really bad, no? More or less. Okay, and real people are not actors. Really? Right now I'm playing a part, to be honest, I'm here enough. I mean, it's like we're performing all the time. I mean, if you put someone that is a non-professional actor in front of a camera, they will be performing, they're acting. They're much more actors than many actors that call themselves actors, because they are already working in a film. I think this is a very kind of this is something that you will discover whilst doing films. I mean, really, you will hit yourself to a brick wall, and it's going to be interesting, like, to see the reaction of, like, yeah, getting to know that, because this is a prejudice, like what you're saying in general. Really, actors can, I mean. There's professional actors. What happens with professional actors? There is a good explanation that that Peter Brook gives in one of his books. I don't know which one.
Open space,
maybe. Yeah. Of why there exists professional actors, and I think it's that one. Maybe. Yeah. He does and I'm gonna do a very bad paraphrase of what he explains, more or less. Okay. So he says. So we have this stage, no? Right now, this stage, and there's one person coming from left of stage to right, and okay, it's all of us, and we're gonna do it, and you know, anyone, I think there might be a couple of people that say no, I don't want to do it in front of people, huh? But there might be only a couple. The rest we will say okay. Now we got to know a little bit each other. Maybe we say okay, fine, we'll do it. Then if we have to do that same journey if there was a jar here of water, and we would have to do the journey with a jar of water, you know, and serve ourselves a glass of water and continue to the right, you know, then there would be like, I don't know, 30% of us would not be able to do it for some reason, or would not be able to do it in front of an audience. It would start to get complicated. Then, I mean, the ultimate case is an imaginary water jar carrying it from left of the things, coming across, all of a sudden the water jar, the imaginary water jar, falls to the floor, it breaks, and then you have to collect it, you have to put your t-shirt and put the water inside a glass, and then continue to, right? I think only 0.0003% will do it properly, or will do it like plausibly, and that's the reason why the professional actors exist, because there's people that we give that kind of, they say, okay, I'll do it, I'll try it. Maybe it doesn't work, but there's people that will say, I'll try it, because that's my job. And it's but it's a good explanation to show. I mean, there is, did you see Carlos Reigada's last movie? Yeah? Post Tenebras Lux, no? Yeah. Okay. Some people are laughing. Carlos Reigadas, he's a director that has worked with non-professional actors most of the time, and in Post Tenebras Lux he finally hit the brick wall of thinking, okay, I need a professional actor. yeah, and it, for a simple reason, it's just that there was no performing, there was nothing. There is something that needs to be. It needs to be a game, a play, something that empathy and interpretation of something, And that's ultimately, I mean, and Carlos Regadas can work with, he is already directed non-professional actors, so he can work with professional actors. I mean, ultimately, professional actors are the ones that you arrive, and when you have a good actors, you say, okay, I have this scene. You might think it's a brilliant scene, but the actors go like, oh, this is a shit scene. This is terrible. Does anyone realize that this is terrible? Yes, everyone realizes. Okay. But this director thinks that it's brilliant. Okay, let's make it work. And you make it work. You make it... They can save the day. They can definitely save the day and make things work. I mean, with Michel Gondry, for example, he's a director that would say, and in this scene, you just fall in love. Is that what you do? And you're like, but okay. And he says, yes, it's there, more or less, you fall in love. And what's great about him is that he's fully putting the trust in, like, and you guys figure it out. I don't know how. It's like you find that moment and you make it. You try to make it work. So it is something that I would advise rather not to be stuck up on that prejudice of like actors are too exaggerated. That's a subjective, completely broad kind of definition and a very simple one, to be honest. Because, I mean, for example, those carnivalesque films, Woody Allen, they are completely exaggerated, but it's brilliant. I mean, it works, no? For example, Woody Allen, or even, I don't know, this year in Cannes, I mean, like, so many films, I mean, that involve this kind of transformations and characters, I mean, people doing... For example, the Dardenne brothers, do you think they're being real when they do their film? I mean, they over-rehearse. They rehearse like hell, I heard. They rehearse a lot. Yeah. And they work with professional actors.
They're not documentaries. Yeah? They're not documentaries.
They're not documentaries, yeah.
This is much artifice.
They rehearse a lot and they make it look like it's happening there, like it's not natural in a way. But they work with professional actors and they make these movies that are completely kind of... chiseled and thought of and rehearsed within the site and with the camera moving, and it's like, okay, well, let's do this and let's try this, and it's all this thing, this construction. You can always do that. I mean, it's kind of it's seen many times. It's not that is not a particular boundary, because then you fall into the trap of thinking you work on negatives and you negate, therefore you're not saying anything. You're completely not putting yourself out there, and it just becomes one of those many hundred thousands contemplative movies where you come out of the movie and think, okay, there is nothing there. Nothing there. You know, I mean, when you negate. Yeah, I mean, it's much more important to be propositive in that sense and put yourself out there, and it's a vulnerable thing, but it is what makes the films ultimately, you know, become something. I mean, it's a... Yeah. And believe me, I love contemplative cinema. I love it. I mean, it's perhaps one of my favorite things, but true contemplative cinema, like Regadas' movies, I love his movies because he puts himself out there a lot. He really, like, throws himself into that. But anyways, we cover a lot of
I think, sadly, we've run out of time. A couple of things. I've spoken to many great directors and very different directors, people like Robert Altman, Michael Haneke, whatever, Nuri Bilge Ceylan, and they always say, trust the actors, let them do it. As soon as you've chosen the right person, that's it. I've interviewed Gael quite a few times over the years, and twice today. And I never tire of listening to him. He's one of the most articulate actors I know. He's also a great person, and he's obviously been very happy to share his thoughts with you today. So please thank Gael García Bernal.